What an honor it is to have Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North here today. I mean, he is truly one of a kind. We can say that about a lot of people, but really, there is no one like Colonel North. I know we're supposed to say, you can applaud. There's a smatter. You got a smattering of applause back there. Lieutenant, yeah, you always should say Lieutenant Colonel, retired, Oliver North. He's working harder now than he's ever worked. You know, I'll call and say, hey, can we get the Colonel on the radio show? Well, he's in Afghanistan right now. Just take a little spin over there. He is a combat-decorated U.S. Marine, as most of you know. I'm going to tell you a couple things you might not know. He's the number one best-selling author, of course. He's the founder of a small business. He's an inventor with 3 U.S. patents. Not just one, not two, but 3 U.S. patents. Underachiever, obviously. Syndicated columnist. He's the host of War Stories on Fox News Channel, which I know you all watch and should watch and share with your friends. He was born in San Antonio, Texas, graduated from the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, and served 22 years as a Marine officer. His awards for service in combat include the Silver Star, the Bronze Star for valor, and 2 Purple Hearts for wounds in action. Assigned to National Security Council staff in the Reagan administration, Lieutenant Colonel North was the United States government's counterterrorism coordinator from 1983 to 1986. He was involved in the planning the rescue of 804 medical students on the island of Grenada. He played a major role in the daring capture of the terrorists who had hijacked the cruise ship Achille Lauro. And after helping plan the U.S. raid on Muammar Gaddafi's terror bases in Libya, North was targeted for assassination by Abu Nidal. He knows about terrorism. It's not just theory in a faculty lounge for him. The infamous terrorist killed in Baghdad, that's Abu Nidal, he's killed in 2002. President Reagan described Oliver North as an American hero. Since 2001, he's been the host of War Stories, the award-winning military documentary series on Fox News Channel, and he's been embedded with more than 55 U.S. and allied combat units. That's worth a little smattering of applause right there. That's something. The amazing thing is Betsy lets him go. He's authored 13 books, all of them New York Times bestsellers. His latest, Heroes Proved, is a gripping tale of unique situations, the intrigue and the duplicity at the highest levels of the U.S. government. I'm telling you, some of the fiction he's writing, too, reads like today's headlines. So check out all of his books. You will not be disappointed. He serves on the board of directors for the National Rifle Association, founder of Freedom Alliance, a foundation providing college scholarships to the sons and daughters of U.S. military personnel killed in the line of duty. And he claims his most important accomplishment is being husband of 1, father of 4, grandfather of 14, but it's really 17 now. We got to update. Anybody else coming at the end of the lunch? Now we have to erase. Okay, 17. He's been a frequent and popular speaker for Young America's Foundation for many years. He always steps up as if he has any free time. He is truly an American hero, and I'm proud to call him for 25-plus years, my dear friend, man of God and family and country, Colonel Oliver North, right here.
Mark just gave me a quote from Ronald Reagan. Well, don't screw this one up. I am grateful to be here, and I'm especially so since Fox gave me the option of being here with you today or being in Kurdistan. And so I am so glad to be back here in Santa Barbara, particularly at the Reagan Ranch Center, because this place brings with it so many memories for me. John and I go back almost as far as Mark and I go back to the service of a great president. And I can say this without any hubris at all, the greatest president of my lifetime. And I'm sure that many of you feel the same way. Let me just, if I may, just a quick show of hands. How many of you have been to the Reagan Ranch before? Okay. How many of you are veterans of any branch of the armed service or the spouse of a veteran? Yeah. So, by the way, that number that for that last count is unusual, because today less than 1% of the American people know the name of somebody serving in our military. Now, I must tell you, it is good to come back here to a place where I know, and that I've been to many times, both back in the 80s and recently back with YAF. I checked into the National Security Council staff in July of 1981. That's before any of you ladies were born, but some of you guys were around here. And at that point in my life, no one knew who I was except that I was a U.S. Marine, which is all U.S. Marines really need to know about one another because it's a special group of people. And of course, a lot of that changed during the hearings of the late 1980s and television doing what it does. But I have learned something. Not everyone still knows. I got stranded in an airport. It was actually at Indianapolis, where I was on a flight to Chicago from the West Coast. And we landed. I shall not name the airline, United. As I told the group upstairs, the reason I can't stay around is I have a special deal worked out with United. They may deliver me to the place for which I have a ticket. They might actually leave on time, and if they do leave on time, they will leave me behind. We, for whatever reason, diverted into... Anybody here been to the Indianapolis Airport terminals, the Concourse C, which is the United terminal? It's a wonderful place for about 200 people. There were about 3,000 people there that night because they were diverting all these flights in there. And I'm looking around desperately at 2 in the morning wearing a baseball hat and sunglasses for a place to plug in my phone so I could call home and tell Betsy why I'm not home. And I finally see an empty plug behind an older gentleman. And I can say older. He is older. And I said, excuse me, sir, with my sunglasses and baseball hat. May I plug in my phone behind you? And he looks up at me and he says very quietly, I know who you are. And, sir, let's not start something in here tonight we can't finish. I mean, the book line took a little while upstairs, right? So I plug in the phone, and he says to me, he says, I used to love watching you on TV. Now, you put it past tense. I just want to make sure everybody understands where I'm coming from. All Fox asks of you is 24/7, 365. Turn the damn thing on in the morning, and don't turn it off, please. That's how I got my job. Thank you for making Fox number one in America. But apparently he stopped because he used past tense. I used to. Then he said to me, I read that book you wrote about World War II. Now, I've actually written 3 books, but maybe you just quit after the first one. I don't know. And then he said, can I have your autograph, Mr. Brokaw? It's 2:00 in the morning. Maybe I'm not wearing enough makeup. And by the way, if the word gets out, Marines are wearing makeup, it's curtains for the free world. And because I have, Betsy's described it, after 48 years, you can do this with your lovely wife. She calls me a smart Alec. It has an A in it, but it's only 2 other letters. And so I take out, Fox gives us these cards so you don't have to tear up a shopping bag at a supermarket. Right? So I reach in the pocket and I pull out this card and it says, War Stories with Oliver North. There's the Fox logo on the bottom of it. It's even got a phone number. No one answers, but it's a phone number. And I take out the card, but I flip it over and I say, to whom shall I make this? He said, make it out to Phil. I write, Phil, all the best, Tom. And I hand him the card, and now I'm feeling pretty smug. You know, feeling... I'm going to get away with this. They're announcing flights are now getting ready to leave. So as I start to walk away, he wipes a tear away and he says, I'm the only happy person in this airport tonight. Now what do you do? I mean, this is a moral quandary. I mean, do you say, hey, I'm not really Tom Brokaw? Do you say, oh, flip the card over, I'll sign the other side? What do you do? What's the right thing to do? When I finally got home, I asked the moral arbiter of my universe, 48 years of it. What should I do? She said, you are such an a-hole. That poor man is going to get home. He's going to take the card out. He's going to show the side that you wrote, Phil, all the best, Tom, to his wife. And he's going to look at the back side of the card. And he's going to say, the dickens is Tom Brokaw carrying Ollie North's cards for? Fox News has given me not only cards to give away to people think I'm Tom Brokaw, but also a wonderful opportunity because I want to just show you a little bit because I do work in the business, some of who they are. And here's the important point. The U.S. military that we have today, damaged as it is from lack of funding and the cuts and the social engineering that this administration has done, is the finest military in the world, and it's the finest military the world has ever known. And that's all because of the man who we honor with this facility. The military we have today, the equipment we're using today, the aircraft, the tanks, the ships, all of it is because of Ronald Reagan. So too is the quality of the force that had been wrecked by the previous administration. In 4 years, Jimmy Carter destroyed what had been a wonderful military, already rocked badly by the disastrous end of the war that I served in and my brothers, but also a military that was still very good. And for 4 years, they cut the federal budget of the U.S. military by 15% every single year. The morale of the troops dropped to rock bottom. I was a rifle company commander in those days. I knew what it was like to take guys out without any ammunition and go bang, bang, bang in the woods. I knew what it was like not to have fuel for our vehicles or fuel for the aircraft or maintenance to fix things. And it was all because of the administration of James Earl Carter, unfortunately the only graduate of my alma mater to make it to the White House. Ronald Reagan knew that was happening. And so Ronald Reagan, when he was running for office, decided he was going to fix it. He told everybody in America that part of his program, should he become president of the United States, was to rebuild America's military, not simply in terms of equipment, although it was a lot of it. His advisors, who were with him for 5 years before he became president, guys like John Lehman and John Marsh, former secretaries of both the Navy and the Army, and those who, Tom Reed, former secretary of the Air Force, they designed a military that was designed for essentially two purposes. The only reasons you have a military. One, to deter war, and number two, to win a war if you have to fight it. And that's what Ronald Reagan set out to do with his 600-ship Navy, a fleet of stealthy aircraft, the M1 Abrams tank, the Bradley fighting vehicles, the upgrade of all of that equipment, the F-18s that are still flying today were built when Ronald Reagan was president. And he set standards for the military because he had people who understood it. He had, as his chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and all of his service chiefs understood what had happened to the military in the 70s. And he just said, I'm going to rebuild it, not just with equipment, but with people. And so he set the new standard. Everybody to come into the military had to be at minimum a high school graduate. You could not have a criminal record. You could not have a drug problem. And the quality of the force grew dramatically. It meant we lost a lot of guys out of the field who had just recruiting commands and recruiting duty, but it changed the world for the armed forces of the United States. Ronald Reagan began that because he knew we had a vicious enemy, the Soviet Union. He knew that China was rising. He knew that we had an insurgency going on in this hemisphere called the Sandinista Revolution, in which they pledged a revolution without frontiers. And Ronald Reagan said, we're going to fix that. He formed an alliance with Maggie Thatcher and Pope John Paul II and stuck it to the Soviets in Poland with solidarity. He stuck it to all kinds of people down in Central America because he said, the Russians are building bases in places like Nicaragua and Grenada that are going to be used against us. Backfire bombers were flying up and down the east coast of the United States with cruise missiles aboard. And so the very first project I worked on was one that was designed to ensure that the presidency could never be decapitated. That's what I did at first. We did a couple of other things. It was a wonderful moment when, after having an American general kidnapped by the Red Brigades in Italy, I was brought in, Bill Clark, whose cousin is here. Pat, where are you? Huh? There you go. Bill Clark was my boss, called me down to the office one day and said, the president wants to make sure we get General Dozier back. He does not like hostages. Some of you may remember the day Ronald Reagan was sworn into office, took his right hand. As that moment happened, the Ayatollahs were releasing the 56 Americans who'd been held for 444 days. And he never even threatened them. He just said, we want them back. And so when General Dozier was the first American to be kidnapped and held hostage since that event, he said, I want them back. At the time, we didn't have programs like Rewards for Justice. The Rewards for Justice program all came about in the late 1980s, 1986 Omnibus Crime Act, where you could actually post a reward for the return of a safe return of an American. And so Ronald Reagan reached out to a gentleman who is nameless to this day, and the gentleman put $1 million in a briefcase and delivered it to my office. And the president said, go take care of it. And so I got on a flight with $1 million in a black briefcase. By the way, in case you're interested, $1 million fits neatly inside a government-issued black leather briefcase as long as the federal wrappers are on the $100 bills. Seriously. I didn't count every one of them. I just started counting packets. And that's a lot of money. Money was delivered to the station chief in Rome. Reward posters were posted all over the place in Italy, saying $1 million reward for the information leading to the safe return of General Dozier, and there's a picture of General Dozier. And if you got it, call this number. The number was actually once set up by the U.S. Intelligence Services with the Special Operations Unit out of Fort Bragg. Phone rang one afternoon. Guy said, I want to come in. I've got info. I've got a picture. Proof of life. He did. He came in with a Polaroid picture of General Dozier being held in a pup tent somewhere in a big warehouse. He said, I want $1 million. No problem. Paco, you can have it. And long story short, after 42 days of being held hostage, U.S. special operators and the Italians went and retrieved him safely without a shot being fired. In the aftermath, I brought General Dozier back, and we brought him into the Oval Office. The president congratulated him on being a free man. The general, at that point, had no idea how this had all happened. And he went and continued his tour back in at West Point. And about a day later, a note that I had written and that the president had signed was delivered to the individual who donated the $1 million. It takes 4 days to get to Dallas. I'm sorry, can't mention that. He calls me up and he says, Sal, he's nameless. Sal, who got the $1 million? I'd like to just put it in my journal. I said, well, so you know nothing is never going to be made public. So I just want to put it in my journal. All right, sir. I didn't know. I called the station chief on the secure line in Rome. And he said, $1 million is right here in my office. It's in the safe. I said, what about the guy, Paco? What's what we call him, Paco? Paco turned the guy in. What happened to him? He says, oh, it turns out the Italians discovered he was part of the murder party that had killed Aldo Moro, the prime minister of Italy. And so they couldn't see giving him $1 million to leave the country. He's locked up. Now, Pat, I don't know if Bill told you this part, but I went back across the street, having learned that $1 million is still sitting at the U.S. Embassy, and I told Bill Clark, Ronald Reagan's closest friend in the White House, we got a problem, boss. He said, let's go up and tell the boss, which is what he called President Reagan. So we go up to the Oval Office, and I walk in, and he says, by this time, I was his Marine. He says, Mr. President, your Marine has got something to tell you. The president looks up and says, well? I said, well, sir, the $1 million that was supposed to be, it's in the office. And he kind of looks down, and he says, well? Does he know that? Says, not yet, sir. He says, well, you probably ought to get it back. And get me another note to him. And so I did. I went back across the pond, got the $1 million, brought it back to the States, put the note in that Ronald Reagan signed again. It was a little more, I thought you'd like to have this back, Ronald Reagan. I got another phone call from the guy in Texas. And he says, you didn't invest it? There's no interest in here. I said, look, at the military we've got today is the one Ronald Reagan created. I want to just show you. This was put together after one of my producers said, how are you going to explain to your grandkids how in 58 embeds you've missed all of this time with them? I've missed birthdays and anniversaries and Christmas. And so he put together this video so that I would have something to show my grandkids, which have grown in numbers since he made this about a year ago. Best educated, best trained, led, and equipped military in history. Dial the volume on that down just a little bit. Bring me up. The equipment that they use is the most sophisticated on the planet, designed so that they can use it, fix it, make it. Every youngster out there is in his hands or in his, what he's doing has got millions of dollars of equipment, and every one of these youngsters has responsibilities that exceed anything of any CEO in America. They've got the lives and safety of every one of them that are their responsibility. Their accountability is extraordinary. What they do with this equipment is what it was designed to do. And they volunteer, still even in spite of the terrible environment today, at unprecedented numbers. Average education, 13 and a half years to come in as an enlisted soldier, sailor, airman, guardsman, and Marine. And what they do with that gear is take it to an enemy who is as brutal as anything that anyone has ever faced in their lives. It's unusual to have to fight an enemy who wants to die in the process of trying to kill you. Every one of us who served knows guys who are willing to die for one another, but nobody actually went into a fight intending to die, and that's what we're up against today. It is one of the most challenging environments that anybody could ever face. And I want to just show you a little bit more of them from frames that were taken over the course of all the time I've spent out there, because these are remarkable young Americans. I ask almost every one of them, why did you come into the service? And they will mention this, even though they may have been in diapers when it happened. Okay? They remember 9/11/01, and I'll ask them, why did you pick a particular branch of the service? And invariably, it's because they had a role model, a dad, a brother, a cousin, a coach, a teacher, a mentor, who influenced them to join that particular branch of service. And what they've become is mentors to others. You consider the fact that an average 18-year deployment, 18 years in the service, they will have now had somewhere between 7 and 10 deployments that have lasted between 6 months and 13 months. And yet they continue to volunteer. The hardship on the families, since so many more of them are married than ever before, is astounding. And yet the press and the media and many politicians denigrate them. We'd had Abu Ghraib beaten like a rented mule for the better part of 7 years now. We've seen Newsweek create a totally fictional story about a Quran being flushed down a toilet in Gitmo, and it took them 3 weeks to acknowledge it was a lie. But meanwhile, thousands of people died. Youngsters who've become the protectors of Muslim women and children, a phrase that's not even contemplated, have become literally the role models for how a woman is supposed to be protected. And when you look at these kinds of things happening, you say, how could they have missed it? How could they misunderstand so much? How could those folks back home not understand this? That is not a staged shot. That's Marja in March of 2011. I was riding with this rifle squad and the dog. Notice the dog on the far right? The rule of thumb over there is never get out of the vehicle or get off the helicopter before the dog, because the dog is the best IED detector, the improvised explosive device detector you've got. And as that dog team joined that squad, a lance corporal, not a lieutenant colonel, not a lieutenant, not even a sergeant, not even a sergeant major, says, guys, Smitty and Dexter, the dog, are going with us. And I'm saying, that's good, because I don't want to get off that helicopter if the dog ain't there. Let's pray for them. And they did. They knelt in prayer. You talk about courage and faith. Look at that. And that's not a staged picture. When you see them kneeling like that, they're not going out on the football field on a Friday night. They're going to mortal combat against an enemy who intends to die, who wants to die. There's one last slide on this thing I want to show you. And this is one I took on April 6, 2003. I showed it first before the NRA. I'd come back a few months before the NRA meeting, the annual meeting that year. And this was shot right after, just before this unit goes into Baghdad, right after they've been ambushed by a Republican Guards regiment, which is numbers about 700, the best of what Saddam had. Most of them are now in ISIS. The fact is, this guy is a Navy corpsman, the one in the middle, about 6 feet, 4 inches tall, about 210 pounds. And he's going out on the battlefield in between the two opposing forces, and there's a crossfire going on. He's picking wounded guys up, putting them battle dressings on them, and bringing them to the helicopter. And I'm now standing on the ramp of the helicopter as he brings the fourth casualty. Unbeknownst to me, on the left-hand side of the screen, as you look at it, a Reuters news crew has come running up toward the fight. Baghdad is the smoke you see on the screen. They've spun the vehicles around to give them offset, because those are not armored vehicles. Those are soft sides, as the troops call them, to give them a little more offset from the RPGs and the 50 caliber machine gun fire aimed at them. And as he lays this casualty down the ramp, the helicopter starts to take a lot of fire, and it starts lifting. And a Reuters news crew shouts out, "Hey, mate!" All the gunfire is now aimed at the helicopter. And I'm running behind the corpsman trying to keep up with him. And he's got my microphone, wireless mic, just like this one, tucked down in his flak jacket. Because up until this gunfight started about 15 minutes before, he and I had just been talking for the benefit of the stuff I'm doing for documentary purposes. "Hey, mate, didn't you notice that wasn't a wounded Marine? That was an Iraqi." Look carefully at the photo. That's not a wounded Marine. That's an Iraqi soldier, a Republican Guardsman, a wounded enemy combatant. Those are American battle dressings, and this corpsman has risked his life to save him. And the Reuters news crew is asking him why he did it. And because this is polite company, I can only put it this way. He gives them a gesture with his left hand. You know, these are nice folks that aren't supposed to get that part. He gives them a gesture and shouts back, and if it hadn't been for the expletives he used, we'd have kept it on air forever. Didn't you bleepers notice he was wounded? That's what we do. We're Americans. Remember those words. Remember those words, because you're going to hear them again from a certain person that understood what Americans are and what America's all about. Here's the bottom line of what I have seen over the last 15 years in those 58 embeds. The bravest, the best of a generation of young Americans had the courage to go into harm's way in places most people can't even pronounce. And they've taken on an enemy that is widely misunderstood in the world. They're in the midst of one of the most difficult and complex military endeavors ever undertaken by any country. And they're in the crossfire. Because of the cowardice of the current administration, and I can put it no other way, when they pulled everybody out of Iraq, they squandered a treasure in the blood of thousands and the lives of thousands who they abandoned in December of 2011. And what we're now facing is a continuation of this at a higher level, with ISIS threatening people as close as San Bernardino. And so it's a different war than it could have been. It should have been ended sooner. It could have been. ISIS probably wouldn't exist today, what for the fact that they pulled out so precipitously in 1 month out of Iraq. I was in Kurdistan last in November, notwithstanding what was up on the internet. I was not wounded, but I did get hurt, came back. And in the space of 3 days after being injured, the United States government at Walter Reed Bethesda gave me a brand new knee. And I got to have my little dog, who was a therapy dog, up there with me the whole operation. And at the end of it, the guy that was my corpsman in Vietnam, who had saved my life on the battlefield of Vietnam and had himself been terribly wounded, and come back, and after years of rehab with traumatic brain injury from a shard of a mortar round through his helmet into his brain in June of 1969, graduated from Hampton City, gone to med school, and come back as a doctor, and is now the expert on TBI and chronic pain and PTS. Jack Fowler is his name, and he's still there. He's retired again. He retired 100% disabled. He retired again as a Navy doc, and now they brought him back again to run the dog therapy program at Walter Reed. And thus the whole idea of a role models. Young guys will walk into Jack Fowler's office, who've been hurt badly and are suffering from it. And Jack Fowler, not being a particularly not a fuzzy-wuzzy kind of guy, because he was a Navy corpsman in battlefield for Marines. And the guy will start to say, well, this is that. And Jack will say, well, tell me about it. And so the guy will talk again. He says, tell me about it. And the guy says, well, do you have any idea what I'm talking about? And then he points behind his desk at the picture of Jack Fowler and me on a battlefield in 1969. And he shows him the Bronze Star and the Purple Heart. He says, tell me about it. Tell me about it. The remarkable thing is that the young Americans that we've got today are unprecedented. The commitment that they've made is unprecedented. And I wouldn't take $1 billion for the guys that I served with in my war, or the ones that served with my dad in World War II or Korea. But the fact is, the quality of our force today, which Ronald Reagan began and built it to where it is, has been passed down from mentor to protege, from mentor to protege, now for over 30 years. I want to show you one last little bit from this war. What you're about to see on the screen is a young Marine captain. Fox did not let me put this on. I interviewed him out there in the battlefield in 15. His name is Matt. Matt is a U.S. Special Operations Marine. He's on his second battlefield tour. And when I brought this interview I did with him back, it's clipped just to save some time. But he's on a battlefield in Afghanistan, and Fox didn't put it on because they thought it was too graphic.
My name is Captain Matt Lampert. This is my second combat deployment to Afghanistan. And I just wish American people would understand there's a lot of people here that still believe in what we're doing out here and are willing to come back again and again to prove that point.
I'm not trying to ruin anybody's lunch, but that's commitment. That's the kind of commitment that 2.5 million young Americans have made. And over 46,000 of them have come back terribly wounded. And one of the things that Freedom Alliance does is make sure that they and their families get the care and the concern and the help that they sometimes need. Matt Lampert's wife is a Marine helicopter pilot. I have some indication from one of them that she may be pregnant. So they got a long ways to go to keep up with us. We had 17 grandkids, but we'll loan them one by name. I do know all their names. I just sometimes get them mixed up as to which is which. What inspires me is their courage, their steadfastness, and the kinds of people they are. Many of you got a copy of that book, Heroes on the Home Front. It's about them and their families. They've made extraordinary commitments. Let me just show you one person who, remember the words of the Navy corpsman? We do that because we're Americans. Well, let me just show you the American who understands what veterans really are from remarks he made in 1984, for which I wrote the first draft, and not one word I wrote for this is in his final, because he wrote it. Here it is.
If we look to the answer as to why for so many years we achieved so much, prospered as no other people on earth, it was because here in this land, we unleashed the energy and individual genius of man to a greater extent than has ever been done before. Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David, they add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom. Each one of those markers is a monument to the kind of hero I spoke of earlier. Their lives ended in places called Belleau Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Pork Chop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. Under one such marker lies a young man, Martin Treptow, who left his job in a small town barber shop in 1917 to go to France with the famed Rainbow Division. There on the Western Front, he was killed trying to carry a message between battalions under heavy artillery fire. We're told that on his body was found a diary. On the flyleaf, under the heading My Pledge, he had written these words: America must win this war. Therefore, I will work, I will save, I will sacrifice, I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the issue of the whole struggle depended on me alone. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. Let that be understood by those who practice terrorism and prey upon their neighbors. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We are Americans.
We are Americans, and we're blessed to live in a country that gives us the opportunity to choose and hire our commanders in chief. Lord willing, we will do the right thing here in November and hire a commander in chief as worthy as Ronald Reagan to lead the finest military on earth. God bless you all, and Semper Fidelis. Thank you.
Say. We have a little bit of time for questions here, which is kind of surprising to all of us, but we do. We got back on schedule. It's amazing. And then he does have to head off to catch his flight. That is so powerful. I mean, you hear, and I keep thinking of all the detractors of President Reagan, you know, all the they still say in this fight. Just unbelievable. You listen to that. It's incredible. Question right over here.
What would President Reagan do with the two Russian jets that flew by and harassed our...
31 times, right?
Yeah.
Strange you should ask. One of the early things that I did was to... one of my jobs when I first got the NSC was to do what we called freedom of navigation exercises in the Baltic, the Black Sea. I mean, Carter had not had any U.S. vessels anywhere near the place. And Reagan basically said, international law and treaties give us the right of free passage in international waters, enforce it. So I can't tell you exactly what he'd have done with this one, but I don't think the Russians would have tried, because what happened in 1981, Muammar Gaddafi had issued his line of death in the Gulf of Sidra, which took international waters out to over 200 miles. And so President Reagan ordered two Navy carrier battle groups to go in to the Gulf of Sidra, go to close to international waters, but then come back out. And on the 18th, they sent up two MiGs, actually SU-22s, I believe, and they launched two Tomcats and two F-18s to chase them back. And they broke off at the 12-mile mark, and the Libyan jets went back to Tripoli. And so when the president was briefed the next morning, and I was there for that, and Bill Clark was there for that, he said, "Well, what? Why did they stop?" And I said, "Well, sir, it's because of the international boundary." He says, well, the next time they threaten the ship, tell them to go chase them all the way back to their hangars." I think that's an exact quote. And so I went back down, wrote it up, signed off by Bill Clark, the National Security Advisor, sent over to the Pentagon. The next day, they tried again, and they shot them both down. So after that, Muammar Gaddafi didn't. It took 5 more years before he ever launched another aircraft in the direction of a U.S. Navy carrier battle group. So, and that was the night we bombed the beans out of him. That was exactly 30 years ago yesterday. Hmm. I think some days of your life you just never forget.
That's right. Yeah. And you really said bomb the beans out of him, right? Back here.
Colonel North, I think in this day and age, I think family is so important. I think the greatest gift parents can give their children is to love one another. And I honor you and commend you for being the husband of one.
Thank you.
You're a great American.
Okay. Well, you can. I must tell you, I married way up. I know it. I'm blessed. This is our 48th anniversary coming up. 4 great kids, 17 grandkids. And I am reminded occasionally on certain anniversary dates, February 11th, 1987, the CIA Counterterrorism Center, which was set up on my watch by a wonderful spy, Dewey Claridge, who died last Sunday, cycle of life thing. Dewey Claridge died last Sunday. Dewey Claridge is a man who founded the Counterterrorism Center, started it in late 1986. By February 87, they'd intercepted the message coming from Muammar Gaddafi and Abu Nidal to kill my family. And they alerted us. We were transported down to Camp Lejeune, spent a month or so down there, and then they formed a what they call a personal security detail out of federal agents at our house in Great Falls. And obviously unscathed. No other wife since the Civil War has had to flee her home with her children because of her husband. And it only happened last time during the Civil War. And so I'm reminded of that by my kids every time I get a little, my hackles go up at something, and my kids would go, "Dad, that's Mom." And so the interesting fallout of all that was in 2002, I was on a mountaintop in Afghanistan with a SEAL team doing the news reports and a documentary when Dewey Claridge called me up on my Iridium satellite phone and said, "You no longer have to sleep with your 45 under your pillow." And I said, "What's the context?" He said, "Abu Nidal is dead. 6 self-inflicted headshots in Baghdad."
Six.
Back here.
Hello. Hello. My name is Alex Madajan. First of all, I'd like to say thank you for your service.
Thank you.
I really, really appreciate all that you've done and all that your brethren have done to protect me, my family, my future family. Thank you. My question is, what is your opinion on corporal punishment in the military?
Corporal punishment? I've had a lot of corporals, but I never punished any of them. Are you talking about physical? Corporal punishment in the old days, in the 1700s, Daniel Morgan, about whom I'm writing a book right now, was actually an American pioneer, was beaten 400 lashes with a whip for back-talking a British officer in 1756, and thus joined the American Revolution against the Brits because he had the scars to bear. That was corporal punishment. I think we're beyond that in our military. In fact, you don't need it. I mean, we have courts-martial, and we have ways of punishing bad behavior. About the biggest punishment today you can give a guy for, you know, mouthing off is dishonorable discharge. Who wants one? I mean, these are remarkable young Americans. And every man and woman I've met over there, I mean, I'm sure there's some, you know, have committed infractions. Sergeant Major's probably got a short list of guys he's had to admonish. But corporal punishment's no longer, thankfully, a part of it.
Okay. Caroline?
Colonel, it's an honor to be on board with you. Larry Mannion, veteran U.S. Army. Sir, with all that we're seeing in the South China Sea and the building of the islands and the Sprats, I believe I pronounced that right.
Yep, Spratlys.
Spratlys, and the severity of what it will do to our shipping lane and the horrific poor leadership of Obama and the destruction of our military, what is your opinion on what we can do and what should have been done under this individual we call our president?
Yeah, were you watching Greta the other night when I did this? I mean, just because that was basically the question she asked me. So what does the next commander-in-chief need to do? Which is going to be enormously challenging because of the destruction of not just the military, but just about everything this guy's touched. I mean, there's not an ally in America today that trusts us. I mean, think, if you're in Manila or Seoul or Tokyo or Jerusalem, the old expression, "I've got your back," well, nowadays that's a slogan for a mattress company because we're not doing it. And so what they're now doing, and I believe that the Saudi Arabians are already up to it. They're buying the Pakistani nukes that they paid for back years ago, and you're going to have the biggest outbreak of nuclear proliferation you've ever seen because they don't trust us anymore to provide that backup. Here's what I wrote. One, the person, I put it in this context, the person I vote for needs to do the following. One, rebuild the U.S. military because it's too small to deter and too small to win right now. Need to define the enemy. It's not just ISIS, it's radical Islam, and you've got to be able to say the words. Define victory. No safe havens for terrorists. Number 4, reassure our allies, Israel, Egypt, Manila, Tokyo, and Seoul, that we really are their friends and that we will come to help them, that we really do have their back. Put Putin and Beijing on notice. No more expansionism. Ronald Reagan would have did that. I'm not going to tolerate it. And so when the Soviets were actively engaged in Grenada, in Nicaragua, certainly in Cuba, the Cubans were fighting as mercenaries for the Soviets all over Africa, he went after them in every case. Now, are all the outcomes super? No. Angola took a long time to turn around. Guinea-Bissau, Mozambique, U.S. special operators working in all those places. He had to send, you know, the Army Rangers and the Marines to Grenada in October of 83. But if your military is good, and it takes years to make it better than it's gotten to be, but thank God we still got the quality of the personnel in it, but you have to rebuild it. And so finally, all of those things, to include protecting the homeland. Putin is now sending SA-300 missiles, arguably the best surface-to-air missile system in the world, perhaps second only to Arrow and Iron Dome from Israel. But we don't have anything like it. And what we ought to do is defend the homeland first, to defend the homeland against terrorists and defend the homeland against when you've got Iranians and North Koreans working together to build ICBMs and nuclear weapons, and we're not doing anything about it, we're in trouble. And we're not doing anything to protect the American people from it. So if you did those things and nothing else as the next commander-in-chief, you'd make America a safer place.
All right, we'll do one more. Go over to the Clark table over here.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir.
Trish.
I'm very, very sorry to hear about Dewey Claridge's death. He and I had been corresponding since the book, yeah. The Judge. And when he told me that he had been recruited from Brown University and his first assignment was to give a cocktail party. And I said, oh, I want to join the CIA. And then my next comment is, would you consider running for president?
a fitting note for me to flee to catch my flight. Look, I'm flattered by it. People have tried to get me to run for lots of things. I was actually convinced to run for the U.S. Senate in Virginia. Betsy's a better shot than I am at this point. The Secret Service cannot protect me from her. I wake up in a pool of my own blood on the kitchen floor hearing her say, how do I reload this thing? I wouldn't put her through it again. I mean, I love the rough and tumble of the campaign. But just to let you know how far back, I mean, that was 1994. Wow, and the Clark family were generous donors from California to my campaign, acknowledge that. When we walked out the night of the Virginia primary, Betsy, it's tradition in Virginia, and if there's any place with traditions, it's Virginia, and I'm married to one of Jeb Stuart's progeny, so she's a Southern lady. And she very rarely raises her voice, much less commits profanity. Or I don't think she's ever profaned, but she's been obscene. And so we're walking out of, and she's now an election official. She had to step aside as a party official, because that's tradition. And so we're walking out of the polling station, and there's blue lights in little tiny Clark County, Virginia, because someone had shot someone else that day, and Black Lives Matter was out protesting. And the sheriff's deputy's there, and a reporter. And the reporter sees me come out. The polls have just closed. We're standing together. I'm carrying the crock pot with the soup in it to the car. And the guy walks up and says, who'd you vote for? He first explained what was going on. The Black Lives was protesting all these. And he said, who'd you vote for? And I said, well, look, you know it's a secret ballot here, even in Virginia. And if I tell you, then I have to kill you. And he kind of, eh. And Betsy says, I voted for Trump. And we both said, you did? And she says, yes. And I think this is quoted this way in the Winchester Star. She says, yes, John Warner screwed my husband. He's part of the establishment. I voted for Trump.
That's right, in the Senate race.
The time I get back, she got back very late because they have to tally everything. And so I said, sweetheart, that was so, I mean, I was choked up about it. She said, don't get any ideas, big guy. I got up at 4 o'clock this morning. It's now 9 o'clock at night. I'm going to bed in Stuart's room. You're not. Thank you. Thank you all very much. Thank you. Calvin's trying to get me out. Yeah. Thank you.
Please stay seated. We're going to get the colonel to his flight. Colonel Oliver North, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. And thanks again to the NRA and the Charlton Heston Society for helping organize and arrange this special event. Give them a round of applause for bringing Colonel North here today as well. You are flying United today, is that right? TSA, it'll be fun. That'll be fun. All right, good luck. We're praying for you. We're praying for you now. Yes, that's good. Thank you again. We have several events coming up you won't want to miss. President's Club members, watch your mailboxes for some exciting news. Coming next week, our next roundtable will not be a luncheon but a dinner banquet on May 3rd, and we'll feature somebody else who's been making a lot of news in recent months, that's Senator Rand Paul. To RSVP, you want to email events@ReaganRanch.org or give us a call. And let's give a round of applause to our Reagan Ranch staffers here at the center and the people who are all busy putting this together. And, of course, anytime you're not sure what to do, just go to ReaganRanch.org or YAF, YAF.org. Again, thanks to our President's Club supporters and the Rawhide Circle members. We'll see you next week. Consider what you heard today. Consider what you saw President Reagan saying there, the whole essence of this. You have a choice. We have a choice to be either a spectator and say, man, that was really interesting, and, oh, I miss those days. Or we can be warriors in the middle of the environment and do something. And that doesn't mean you got to suit up. You don't have to go and be deployed. I thought I was pretty cool stuff. I've done 3 deployments, embeds, like Ollie's done, until he said I've done 55. It's like, if you ever had a chance to do that just once, you would come back with a fresh understanding of what this country is all about and why we do what we do, and you got a sampling of that today. So you don't have to be putting on the flak jacket. You don't have to be going into war zones, but you can donate to this organization. And that's not so much a plan of what we do at Roundtable Luncheons as much as it is just a reminder. When you go to ReaganRanch.org or YAF.org, look for something that kind of floats your boat. And when you say, man, I wish we had this kind of thing in this country again, that's what this organization does on campuses with the high school students, with the college students. Every day of the year, it's a 24/7 deal, and you're part of it by being here today. So thank you very much. God bless you. God bless the United States of America.